Good afternoon and welcome. I just have a very brief announcement to make before the festivities. Somebody who's not here with us this year, but who was a founding member of the Folk Alliance and who has contributed immensely to it, Gene Shea. We want to remember him. He's still quite alive, but we want to remember him in perpetuity with a special scholarship fund. We're calling the Gene Shea Folk DJ Scholarship Fund. It's to bring a new folk DJ to Folk Alliance every year. And there's a couple of ways you can help. You can donate to the Folk Alliance through the website or however you wish to do it, or you can nominate a young folk DJ who you think should be considered for the scholarship fund. All the information will be on the Folk Alliance International website at folk.org. So we hope that you'll support the Gene Shea DJ Scholarship Fund and make his name part of our tradition. And now I'd like to welcome the Executive Director of Folk Alliance International, Angus Finnan.
Good afternoon, folks. It's an honor to be here. It's an honor to be your executive director, and thrilled that you've gathered here today with us to celebrate one of the luminaries of our community. Before introducing our keynote speaker today, we're going to share one of the projects that was launched last year and is continued this year, and certainly we hope to continue it year to year, which is our Artist in Residency program. And for those of you who were here last year, you'll recall that we partnered Nashville-based artist Brandy Zidane with the Kansas City Ballet in the creation and collaboration of a new work that was launched at their New Moves Festival. This year, we approached and partnered with the National World War I Museum and Monument, and they came on board, and I really do need to thank Laura Vogt for as the KC Ballet did last year, this year taking a leap of faith and partnering with an organization who promised to bring in a folk singer to create art from their archives. Our artist this year was given access to the unreleased digital archives and letters of local residents involved in World War I. I'll let him explain it in depth, but what it results in is the creation of a piece of work that stands alone outside of the career of an artist, outside of the place in industry, and brings to life the story of someone like so many whose stories could have disappeared into time. And if that isn't the heart of folk music, I don't know what is. So I would like to welcome to the stage the National World War I Museum and Memorial's Director of Strategic Engagement, Linda Trout, to introduce our artist in residence this year and share some thoughts from their perspective on this residency program.
Good afternoon. Good afternoon. The National World War I Museum and Memorial, which is located right across the street, is America's museum dedicated to remembering, interpreting, and understanding the Great War. That war from June 1914 through November 1918 was history's first global conflict. It involved not only Europe, but countries from every inhabited continent. From the vantage point of history, 100 years later, there is consensus that the Great War changed everything. Over 37 million casualties and millions of men, women, and children were killed or injured and suffered from its after effects. Empires were lost, national boundaries were reshaped, economies were devastated. Understanding the facts of the Great War through current events and numbers is vitally necessary, but certainly not sufficient. Expressions of feeling and memory through the arts are one of the best ways for making the events of a century ago meaningful for today's audiences. The National World War I Museum collaborates with the Kansas City Symphony, the Kansas City Ballet, the Kansas City Repertory Theater, the Nelson Atkins Museum of Art, and several other arts groups to more fully communicate the reverberations of war, imparting essential truths of the First World War, as well as of all wars, is the joint work of the National World War I Museum and Memorial and artists working yesterday and today. In that regard, it is my privilege now to welcome this year's artist in residence, Joe Crookston.
Thank you so much. Thanks. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Linda. Thank you, Angus. It takes a lot to get me into a suit coat, and this would be the moment. I want to really give a big shout and thank you to Angus. He called me a couple months ago and said, Joe, I would like you to come. Would you like to come to Folk Alliance and be an artist and create and bring your gifts in whatever form you'd like? Bring your paintings, and I'd like you to collaborate possibly with the World War I Museum and create art. And I thought about it for 2 seconds, and I said, yes, I have no idea what I'm doing, but yes, I will be there, and nothing means more to me than that. So thank you to Folk Alliance and for inviting me to do this. And yeah. And basically saying, be the best artist you can be. Dig in, learn, grow, and present to the community something that you are inspired by. And I couldn't be more thrilled. And my daughter my daughter was born on March 8th, which is International Women's Day. And so we were determined to raise an I Am Woman, Hear Me Roar daughter. And it's getting a little out of control at our house. And she helped me. You're going to see a video. And she's one of my videographers now. So I collaborated not only with the World War I Museum, but my daughter. And I'd like to just say that she was part of this project. And for me, what happened is I got to look at letters and archived footage and field recordings. And I told the museum right away, if I work on a collaboration, I know that I want it to be a human story. That's what I feel is where my power or where my most interest is, in the human universal story. And I'm not saying that I'm not interested in World War I, but I would say that for me, that human story is greater than that story. And for the leading and the reading, the letters led me to a woman named Florence Hemphill. And doing this project with my daughter as celebrating this strong woman who was, and women in general were not written in the history books as much, the nurses in World War I. It's a lot about the soldiers, which makes sense, but women have gotten overlooked. And I thought, that's not gonna happen in my project. And I felt like I wanted to celebrate and honor Florence Hemphill as a woman and as a nurse and have my daughter grow up in a world where she can be honored and celebrated as a strong woman. So. So I would like to say that Florence Hemphill, the niece, Florence Hemphill's niece, Catherine Carter, is in the audience here. And we'd like to welcome her to the community, to say that the name Hemphill is a Scottish name. And she mentioned a lot about her tartan and was given a kilt by one of the soldiers when she was in France. And I've been learning how to play the fiddle, and I thought I would begin by a little fiddle music in a somewhat of a bagpipe Scottish tradition. And then eventually you can turn your attention over here to a short video, and I'll sing you a song. So thank you very much, and I really appreciate being here with y'all.
Thank you. I came back home to Wilson County in the gold Kansas plains, from the gutted hills of France and the cold muddy rain. And I still think about the sisters, the cigarettes and English tea, and the barbed wire and trenches, things we never thought we'd see. And in the rumbling battle noise, we took care of the boys so they wouldn't die alone, and we could send them back home. When the midnight whistle blew, I donned my boots in navy blue. But anyhow, that's all over now. Jimmy Clellan was a piper. They brought him in from no man's land, and I fed him the ripest berries, and I saved his one good hand. And that redhead with the photograph, as I wrapped up his eyes, if he got home to West Virginia, I knew he'd never see his bride. In the rumbling battle noise, we took care of the boys so they wouldn't die alone, and we could send them back home. When the midnight whistle blew, I donned my boots in navy blue. But anyhow, that's all over now. And all the sleepless nights we spent, and all the letters came and went, and all the British girls and I, we lost some, but we tried. We lay down in the bracken fern to make it through. We had to learn about the broken and the torn, mending lives and staying warm. Coming home to the prairie gold with this story that I told in the rumbling battle noise. We took care of the boys. I came back home to Wilson County in the gold Kansas plains, from the gutted hills of France and the cold muddy rain.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you, Joe. For those of you who haven't had a chance to see the original painting that he created from the one known photograph of Florence Hemphill, the painting is out on display in the foyer with some of his other work. That painting and this song will be on display and available for listeners and viewers who come for years to come at the National World War I Museum and Monument, which sits solemnly just on the hill to the west of this property. to introduce today's keynote speaker, I'd like to welcome to the stage one of our board of directors, Amy Reitenauer.
Thanks, Angus. Hello. It's so wonderful to see all of you people out there and to see just how many folks are crammed along the walls, and it's really not a surprise based on who's about to walk on stage. It gives me great honor to introduce this year's keynote speaker. As an artist, she's inspired audiences with her sublime vocals, boldly vulnerable personal life triumphs, and a firm commitment to social activism. In the 1960s, she evoked both the idealism and the steely determination of a generation united against social and environmental injustice. With an iconic 50-album body of work, she is known for her imaginative interpretations of traditional and contemporary folk standards and her own poetically poignant original compositions. She's collaborated with countless legends, garnered several top 10 hits, and had gold and platinum selling records. As impressive is her continued relevance and presence in the active creative community and touring industry. She has just released in 2015, Strangers Again, a record with a cast of icons and new young talent to sing with her on this fresh collection. It includes Willie Nelson, Jackson Brown, Jeff Bridges, but also Ari Hess and Glenn Hansard. She's a legendary woman who really needs no other introduction. Ladies and gentlemen, Judy Collins.
Oh, I'm so happy to be here. Thank you. I thought I better come out here in the middle. Is it okay? Can I stand here in the middle? The first thing I want to say is hello. Thank you for inviting me. Hi, Betsy. Oh, my God, my history is all here in this room, I think. Well, to get this out of the way, rows and flows of angel hair and ice cream castles in the air. Feathered canyons everywhere, I've looked at clouds that way, and now they only block the sun. They rain and snow on everyone. So many things I would have done, but clouds got in my way. I've looked at clouds. Sorry, I just came from Colorado. I've looked at clouds from both sides now, from up and down, and still somehow it's clouds' illusions I recall. I really don't know clouds at all. Thank you. Thank you so much. I want to tell you the whole story. I have so little time to do that, but I want to tell you, first of all, how grateful I am and how privileged I've been to have this amazing career, which started the first time I sang in public. I was in Butte, Montana, and my father had a radio show for 30 years, and he sang all the songs of Rodgers and Hart and George Gershwin. We used to call that, you know, the Great American Songbook. Now we call it the Rod Stewart Songbook. he wanted me to have a proper training on the piano. So I studied piano for many years. But in that first stepping out on the stage, I was four, and I had my little. Oh, thank you. That's so nice. Thank you so much. Water for a change. I used to, you know, I never did a lot of drugs. I mean, you know, it was always known as the sex, drugs, and rock and roll era. But I tell you why. I didn't do those so many drugs because I was really afraid it would interfere with my drinking. So, but going on, getting back to the beginning, there I was. It was the stage, and it was in Butte, Montana. My father was on a little tour, a little run in the Northwest, which all of you, by the way, Joe, your song is so beautiful. Ah, and because I was born a fan, I mean, this is how this all happened. I was born a fan of people singing songs and choosing gorgeous songs and writing beautiful songs. That's where this all really came about. So there on the stage in Butte, Montana, I was 3 and a half, and my dad said, why don't you sing a little song? So he played the piano, and I sang, I'll be home for Christmas. You can plan on me. I had a little plaid dress on, my pigtails, you know. And please have snow and mistletoe and presents on the trees. It was a wonderful hit. It was also April. And so as the years went on, of course, I played the piano, I sang in the shows, I starred in, I was in Snow White, and I sang, someday my prince will come, someday I'll find my love. My prince was Wally, and he was 10 years old. He was interested in nothing about me. He was very interested in the glass casket. My father said he was a necrophiliac in the making. Which I tried to keep my father out of these performances of mine, and because he was an enthusiast, but he also would say anything that came to mind. Anyway, he was an amazing man. He was a great singer. He wrote some awfully good songs, truly. I would sing some, but I don't have time, but I will later when you find me in the hallway. But I played quite seriously on the piano. I have to get this in. I studied with a great teacher. I played Mozart symphony with a concerto with the orchestra with another young man named Danny Guerrero, who's a trumpet player and has his own band in California. And we did beautifully. It was the 2nd of February in 1953. We were at Phipps Auditorium in Denver, and everybody loved it. Both of the people who came loved it. It was a full symphony orchestra, but there was a blizzard that night. Huge blizzard. Anyway, a few years later, after many traumatic things, I know I grew up in a dysfunctional family. It was a lot of music, a lot of fun, we had, my father sang the Irish song, so we had the Irish Alzheimer's in our life, which is that's where you forget everything but the grudges. And then we had the Irish virus, you know, so we drank a lot. But I once said to, and then I'll get on with my story, Joan Rivers said to me, you have nothing on my dysfunctional family. I knew, she said, I knew that I was an unwanted child because my bath toys were a toaster and a hairdryer. And I said, I could not live in my life without humor. So I grew up on it. For the record, I heard two songs when I was about 15. The gypsy rover came over the hill, down through the valley so shady. He whistled and he sang till the greenwood rang, and he won the heart of a lady. Would you like to sing this chorus? Ah-dee-doo, ah-dee-doo, da-day. Ah-dee-doo-la-dee-day-dee. He whistled and he sang till the greenwood rang, and he won the heart of a lady. It's an old song, ancient song, you know, girl turns 16, runs off with a hippie. Her father gets on horseback, races into the woods, and finds out that he's run off with Bill Gates. So everybody is happy. My life that day was completely altered. And aside from singing, of course, I'll Be Home for Christmas in Butte, Montana, this is the day that changed my life. I went down to Wells Music. I bought the record. I brought it home. I thought my friends and I, my friends were dancers, and we'd been doing the story of Little Red Riding Hood for years. We were going to take it to Las Vegas, but we really needed new material, and I thought the Gypsy Rover would be perfect. And it was. And I did that on the stage. I got a pianist and a guitar player, and then I convinced my father, this was it. The next song I found was Barbara Allen, you know, "'Twas in the merry month of May when the green buds were swelling." And Mozart just paled in comparison. So it was that day and those songs that changed my life. I was so fortunate. First of all, I started singing around Denver. I joined the Denver Folklore Society, went up to Lookout Mountain, was Lingo the Drifter. Lingo the Drifter was a man who came to Denver with only that name and educated everybody about Pete Seeger and Woody Guthrie and had a radio show like my father. He would come over to the house and he would sing, "This land is your land, this land is my land, from California to the New York Island." And my father would sing, "Some enchanted evening." They got along very well. They were on the same side politically, but they argued about it at very loud voices after and during drinking my father's whiskey. So pretty soon I had jobs in Denver and jobs in Boulder and in up in the mountains at little towns, places like the Gilded Garter in Central City. And then I found my way quickly to Chicago, to the Gate of Horn. Now, I met everybody. When I started singing in Denver, I worked with Josh White, I worked with the Terriers, I worked with the great, and people don't remember him as much as they should. I had a lot of friendships with artists, and Josh was particularly wonderful to me. He told me a lot of things about what it was like to be on the road and what it was to make a living. You know, Josh was, he did the first concerts at the White House. The Roosevelts adopted him, really. And Eleanor Roosevelt used to take him to Europe after the war, after the Second World War, and have him speak. And he would never talk about racism overseas. He told her that he wanted to do that at home, where it would have an effect. He had a great effect on me, Josh White. And when I got to the Gate of Horn, Sonny Terry and Brownie McGee were there. I met Odetta there. I was just exposed to so many great artists who were on the road like I am, like I think all of us are on the road. Is that right? Many, many, many of us. And have been. You know, I've been doing this for 57 years now. 56, sorry. But I figure, you know, it's the second oldest profession in the world, and I don't at all regret it. When I got to New York in 1961, I got to Gertie's Folk City, and everybody was there. And I was a headliner, which I couldn't get. I couldn't understand why I was a headliner, because I'd only been doing this for a couple of years. But then, and everybody seemed to be there. All the people I'd heard on Folkways Records and Elektra Records and Vanguard, and they were all there. And then I realized that when I found out, I knew why, because my opener was a 13-year-old named Arlo. But I of course got to know Pete Seeger because my manager was Harold Levinsohl, who managed everybody he managed the Weavers and Pete Seeger and Arlo and Woody and Theo Bakel. And so I got to know and adore Pete, and of course, one of my first recordings with after I got over only being able to sing traditional songs was, of course, "To everything, turn, turn, turn. There is a season, turn, turn, turn. And a time to every purpose under heaven." And I slowly but surely began to record the songs of the City Singers. I recorded Dylan very early. You know, he was at Gertie's. He'd been in Colorado with a different name and couldn't get a job. And he was there at Gertie's Folk City. And I thought, God, he's just pathetic, really. pathetic. He was singing old Woody Guthrie songs, you know, and badly, I thought. Badly chosen and not well sung. I mean, and then, of course, the phenomenon hit us, and I was there at Newport with Pete when Pete was said to have tried to have cut the cord on the guitar. He didn't, and he denies it. But I don't think he was thrilled. But, you know, he got over it. That's the thing about Pete. He got over a lot of things, including history that you know very well about his being blacklisted. But he gave us so much. He was so amazing. Where have all the flowers gone? Sorry, I really have a terrible cold and I shouldn't be in bed. Long time passing, but we're all here together, so that's okay. Where have all the flowers gone? Long time ago. Where have all the flowers gone? Young girls have picked them, everyone. When will they ever learn? When will they ever learn? Pete was an inspiration, and in those days, of course, as soon as I started to sing and record everybody's songs, which I did, I began to get invitations to listen to songs and singers, and I didn't write any songs myself. So I was unusual in that respect, and I was with a lecturer, and a lecturer was learning. They were Jack Holson was a wonderful man and is still a friend. But they were learning about how to do this. I mean, how to take that song that Joe just wrote and do something. I don't know how the music business works anymore, please. Forgive me, I have no clue. I have a brand new CD, which was mentioned before. It's called Strangers Again, and I am very happy that it's been very successful. And I'm happy for the people who are on it singing with me. Of course, Ari Hest, who's wonderful, and of course, Michael McDonald and Jeff Bridges and Jackson Brown and Willie Nelson, who all joined me on this record, but I had no idea where it would go or how it would go. I'm very happy to say it's on my own label, which I started in desperation about 15 years ago. And also, they're great artists, all of them seasoned and professional, and even if they're young and not as well known as some of the others, it's fantastic. In fact, I'll preview the night by saying that Ari Hest and I are doing a premiere this evening, where, I have no idea, of our new CD of songs we've written together called Silver Skies Blue. So you might want to, I hope you will, find and join us. But it's been an adventure. I've never done anything like that before. But I was always drawn, as I said, I started out as a fan. I was always a fan of great songs. And people kind of found out about it. In 1966, my friend Mary Martin called me, and she said, she's not the one who flies. She's a wonderful woman who went to school with Leonard in Canada. And she used to always talk about this guy, always such a good poet. He writes these really obscure poems, and she talked over dinner and various social things. And in 1966, she called me and she said, well, Leonard has written some songs and he wants to come to see you. I said, are they obscure? She said, oh, yes. So this good-looking guy came to the door and I said, hi, you know, are you Leonard? Yes, he's Leonard. He came in. He did not sing a song. You know, nowadays, or any time, if a singer-songwriter comes to your house, I'm thinking of Eric. I'm going to tell a story about Eric, too, because I know Eric's here. They come to your house, and in the case of Eric, Eric Anderson came over with Phil Oakes to my house a couple years after this happened, because he'd heard, no, it was 2 years earlier, and he'd heard that I was going to record In the Heat of the Summer, When the Pavements Are Burning. That's right. And he knew that I was going to record this song of Phil's. And Phil brought him to my house and said, look, she's going to record these songs, and get over there and sing something. So Eric came to the door. Where are you, Eric? Are you there? Ah! Well, he came to the door, and he said, excuse me. And he walked into the room. He said, can I use your restroom? He's very tall and good looking. I said, of course you can use my... I thought maybe he was moving in. I didn't know. I mean, in those days, who knew? And he stayed there for a while I talked to Phil about the Yippies and about what was going on with Dave Dillinger and so on. And pretty soon, out comes Eric Anderson, and he says, well, here it is. He'd finished the song. Take off your thirsty boots and stay for a while. That's it. So that's the way I found songs that way, was Eric Anderson coming to the house and going off to write, to finish the song and then singing it to me. So when Leonard came to the door, he said, well, he had a guitar with him, but he said, I can't sing and I can't play the guitar, and I don't know if this is a song. And he did not sing a song, unlike Eric. He didn't sing anything that day. We talked. I had a couple friends there. I was living with this great English guy who was very lovely, and we all had. And then we went out to dinner at Tony's, the local pizzeria. He didn't sing anything at all, and he left. And I said, "Did you want to sing a song or two?" And he said, "Well, I don't know. Maybe I can come back tomorrow." And he did. He came back tomorrow, and he picked up the guitar and he sang. Suzanne takes you down to her place by the river. You can hear the boats go by. You can spend the night beside her. And you know that she's half crazy. And that's why you want to be there. And she feeds you tea and oranges that come all the way from China. And just when you mean to tell her that you have no love to give her, she gets you on her wavelengths and lets the river answer that you've always been her lover. So I said, oh, well, that's a song, Leonard. Things have happened that way all along for me. Songs have flown in the transom. They used to have transoms in the old days. I don't know if they have them anymore, but it's that kind of slatted window above a door in old hotels. And they sort of drifted into me. And it's starting with the Gypsy Rover and Barbara Allen, and continuing to this day. One of the songs on Strangers Again is called When I Go. And I was putting, now you know who he was. I didn't know who he was. I mean, I was shocked I didn't know who he was. So I'm talking to all these singers, we're deciding on the songs, and Strangers Again, I sing, of course, with Ari. And then I'm looking, and Jeff Bridges decides he wants to sing a song from Candide, and which I didn't know, which was wonderful. But then I found this song. Somebody sent me this song, and I printed it out, and I looked at it. I said, oh, this is a great song. It's a great song. Where did it come from? I have no clue. I was starting to learn it. And I asked this one and that one. I asked people I know in New York who are song people, who work for publishing companies, who are friends of mine. Russ Teitelman, I called him. Did you send me this? No. I have a fan who's been to see me 99 times since 2012. One day we were talking and she said, oh no, I sent it to you. It's a Dave Carter song called When I Go. And I called Willie because we were trying to figure out what to sing. He said, oh no, I know Dave Carter. I love that song. So things like that. Now, one night in 1967, I was sound asleep. I'd been working steadily. I'd made 6 albums. One of them in my life was a huge departure because I decided to use an orchestra instead of guitars, and I didn't know what kind of trouble I was in. I mean, I got the worst guitars, the worst reviews from that album of any ever, and I didn't know about it until a couple of years ago. It would have stopped me in my tracks, I think. But never mind. I mean, I had to do what I wanted, and nobody ever told me what to sing or how to sing it or where to go or what to do. So I was sound asleep in 1960, and I was on the road all the time, as I'm on the road now. I had wonderful, successful, somebody's holding a little sign here. It says, stop, you fool. You've gone on so long and you've said very little of any importance. So I'm lying in bed in 1967, feeling I'd started to make a little money, bought my mother a car, sent my parents to Hawaii. Sad, actually. Anyway, because my dad didn't like it and he got sick. Anyway, I had some success, but anyway, I'm lying in bed, 1967. Of course, I wasn't asleep, I was passed out. We know about 1967. Surely we do. By now, we know. I was just in Colorado. That's probably who got this little thing here. Breathing in when I should have been breathing out. But never mind. So the phone rang up. It's 3:00 in the morning. Answer the phone. It's Al Cooper. He says, hi, how are you doing? I'm okay. He was a good friend, not a lover, very good friend. And he had my phone number. I often wonder what would have happened if he had had Buffy's number, perhaps, or Jones, Baez, who discovered silk when we all thought it was polished cotton. And of course, she knew who Dave Carter was. She found him, I know. So he said, well, I followed this girl home, and she was at the bar with the band. She'd fallen in love with the drummer, I think, and she said she could write songs, and she's good-looking, so I followed her home, and guess what? And then he put Joni Mitchell on the phone, and she sang, Rose and Flows of Angel Hair. And I thought, oh. So I said, I'll be right over. Which I was. This has happened numerous times to me. I am so blessed to have the kind of audiences I have in the country and the world who followed along with all of the changes that have come into my music. After I met and recorded most of Leonard's songs, he said to me one day, why are you not writing your own songs? And I said, I don't know. But when a monk asks you such a thing, you have to go. So I went to the piano and I started noodling and I wrote, what I'll give you since you've asked is all my time together. Take the rugged sunny days, the warm and rocky weather. And actually, he's actually recorded that song and so has Joan, which is nice. And ever since then, I've written my own songs also right along the way. And it's been increasingly clear to me that I was meant to do this. I was trained, in a way. It's a family business. I learned so much from my dad, who was a guy who never missed a date and never didn't show up in spite of his own issues. Life has been terrible to me. I just lost my brother, Denver. A couple of weeks ago. In fact, he died two weeks ago this morning from cancer. And of course, my dad's gone, my mom is gone. My son took his life some years ago. And I know that this is true, that everything that happens to me, I have to write about it, I have to sing with it in mind, I have to pursue the music that's been given to me, and it is a total gift. To find my way, and I think that's why we all do this. I think we love what happens when we hear these great songs to our own hearts, and also what happens to us when we think about things in a way that is going to make whatever happens to us turn into something that could help somebody else. I think that's what music is all about. We need it. It allows us, I guess, to live on this planet. This beautiful, terrible, terrifying, amazing planet. I was in an encounter group in 1970. The encounter group included most of the people in my life, my manager, my producer, some of my best friends, and we were tearing each other apart, of course, and my producer said, I think you should sing something and calm everybody down. And I sang the only song that I could remember that my grandmother taught me, that I thought some people at least would know the words to. And I sang it, and he called me the next day, and he said, you have to record that song. As I said, the transom. So now I think it's always a good idea to close an evening of an afternoon of talking about and thinking about music with Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. Through many dangers. Oh, before we sing this next verse, I would like you to join me and sing the harmony or the melody or another song entirely. If you like, only because it's the spirit that counts. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. Of course, it's a perfect song because it's written by a man who experienced a total transformation in his life and dedicated the rest of his life after being a slave trader, as you know, and having a shipwreck that he survived, devoted the rest of his life to writing hymns and fighting against racism. Through many dangers, toils, and snares, we have already come. Through many dangers, toils, and snares, we have already come. 'Twas grace that brought us safe thus far. 'Twas grace that brought us safe thus far. And grace will lead us home. Amazing grace. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Beautiful. Was blind, but now I see. Thank you so much. Oh, Angus.
We'll exit from here. Thanks. Yes.
Thank you, Judy Collins. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for sharing this time. Thank you, Judy, for sharing your thoughts, your songs, your memories, and part of the inspiration behind all of what we do. Folks, there is a reception starting in the foyer, hosted by the I'll Fly Away Foundation. Please do meet with friends, new and old, and enjoy the rest of the night.